We have maybe one more lesson left in Philippians, or two at the very most, and then we'll be moving out of this book that we've been in for some time. And what I thought I would do, in relationship to what we're going to be doing in the future, we have been moving through the book of Philippians, and there have been two different topics that last year when I asked you to write down the things that you wanted to study, lots of different things came up, but one of them was the book of Philippians, so that's what we have been doing for almost a year now. And integrated with that was the second topic, and that was Christ in the Old Testament. And at Christmas time, we took off some time last year to study some direct concepts of Christ in the Old Testament, such as the angel of the Lord. The angel of the Lord, any time that you find that reference in the Old Testament, is a reference to Christ. And so we basically went through all of those particular sightings and the different places that you could see the voice and the figure and the mind and the heart of Jesus and his pre-carnate form, and really a demonstration of who he really was and is to this day. When he was here upon this earth, of course, he took on the form of a man. But the angel of the Lord is more the figure of who he was and is now. So we were looking at that and saw that and tried to integrate that. When we got to Easter, we were in Philippians chapter 3, and I was going to use that time to also open up some more parts of the other typologies and the different things that are a part of the Old Testament that prefigures who Christ is and gives us a lot of information about that, and different approach. But we got into Philippians chapter 3, where the main thrust of Philippians has to do with the power of the resurrection and what that means in our lives and his sufferings. So we were in verses 9, 10, and 11 at the time, so I didn't shift, because it was really the meat of the book of Philippians, and it had direct reference to Easter itself. Okay, so we didn't make the shift. So what I was planning to do is to make that shift. So when we finish this, we will spend some time on the topic of Christ in the Old Testament. And it's more topical. It's not like going through verse by verse. So we'll do a bit of that, and then we'll have to decide where we're going to go from there. So you'll need to help me begin to think in that direction of what it is that you would like for us to do. That will take us, you know, four or five lessons or what, you know, in terms of where we're going. Okay, so that's kind of the direction of the class and where we're heading into the future here. Again, you can pick a topic, or you can pick a book that is either a long book or a short book or whatever, and that's, I'll take all of those things into consideration. Any questions on that? As to what's going on and where we're going here, since we're drawing this to a close. Last week we began studying the passage 14 through 19, and we didn't finish that, so we want to go ahead and go on into that. Let me pick up verse 13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Verse 14, nevertheless, you have done well to share with me in my affliction. And you yourselves also know, Philippians, that at the first preaching of the gospel, after I departed from Macedonia, no church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, but you alone. For even in Thessalonica, you sent a gift more than once for my needs. Not that I seek the gift itself, but I seek for the profit which increases to your account. But I have received everything in full and have an abundance. And I am amply supplied, having received from Epaphroditus what you have sent, a fragrant aroma, an acceptable sacrifice, well-pleasing to God. And my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. If you notice as you go through this passage, this has to do with verse 14 particularly, where Paul is saying, You shared with me in my affliction. And last week we looked at that in reference to the previous context, which had to do with Paul being content and finding the secret to contentment. Of course, we've gone through that and shared with you what the secret of contentment is. And what we find in verse 14 is Paul said, however, even in the midst of my contentment of the situation that I am in prison and I am facing death, and I did have physical needs that needed to be supplied to me that weren't, okay, I was content with that position, but God came along and shared through you with me in a very important area of my life, what he called an affliction, okay? And so then we find the word share used two other times in this passage. And so what you're having is a just off-the-cuff kind of remark by Paul in terms of the topic of sharing. We would call it giving, but actually it's better to be called sharing, okay? Because very often when you think of giving, you think of money. And money is an important part of this issue, but sharing is more the giving of one's life, okay, to another person. We're talking about a psychological, we're talking about a spiritual, and we are talking about a physical giving, okay, that is far more than just writing a check and handing it over to somebody. This is a far deeper type of giving, because these people have been a part of his life all the way through. Not only did Paul bring them the gospel, and they responded, and there was a bond, but that bond went all the way to his death. And many people consider Philippians, Stuart Briscoe wrote a book on Philippians, which I've used in a bunch of other commentaries, and he calls it Bound by Joy. And he considers that this book is a book on joy as a person faces death. And one of the things that basically encourages Paul throughout that whole experience is this is what he's explaining here. The encouragement comes from the depth of friendships and what God has done with those friendships in your life. And it has to do with your own family. It has to do with people who are part of your own life. But essentially the joy comes from these friendships. And the friendships are based on a lot of different things, but a lot of them have to do with sharing, the participation of one person in another person's life. Okay? And I think that that's something that we need to be very, very, very much aware of, that is the warp and the woo of who we are. God is really in the business of using your life to share with another person's life. And in the midst of their affliction, you are to move to share with them. God has literally chosen to uplift another person, like Paul is being uplifted here, okay, being supplied, okay, how's he being supplied? He's being supplied by the grace of God, but the instrument is a person. So everybody in this room has an opportunity, a great opportunity, in relationship to allowing God to use your life in a significant manner, okay, to supply somebody else's life. In fact, we looked at that last week, and that really is, in some ways, the great significance of your life. The great significance of your life is what you share on a day-to-day basis with each individual person that you run into. And unfortunately, we're myopic. We don't see that very well. I mean, we have a list that we're trying to get through each day, and many of us are so pedantic with this that we really have a list, and type A people, and we've got this little list, and we're going to get through this list, hook or crook, you know, and the list becomes it's the driving force of your life, you know, the project that you must do the next day, and if you look at that project, what you find is that the project doesn't really often have to do with people directly. Okay? Washing their clothes or teaching them or, you know, the different kinds of things, seeing patients, okay? That's the project, see? And people are involved in each one of that. But what you find is there is no sharing of affliction. It's the marking of the lips. You know, how many people do I have to see by noon? You know, what's the quota I have to meet? You know, you get this list in your mind, and it really has to do with people, you know, taking care of your kids, driving them one place to the other. But what the sense is, well, you know, you kind of go, ah, it's gone. They're gone to school. You know, I finally got them off. You know, what happens is the child is lost in the middle of the doing. And so there's no real sharing of affliction. And so that's what we have to be aware of. God has chosen to make your life significant by sharing. That is really his instrument of supplying the need to somebody else. And you can be a part of that, or you can cut it off, okay, by marking all the lists. And so it's an important issue that you see here. There are three parts that Briscoe said about sharing, three steps to sharing. Okay, he calls them identification, interest, and involvement. And he uses the Good Samaritan parable to demonstrate that. That's found in Luke chapter 10, verses 30 through 37. And he said, if you take each three of these men that basically were a part of handling this particular person's need who was hurt along the side of the road, you can see the steps of sharing. The first one was done by the priest. It's identification of the problem. Identification of the problem. You have at least the insight enough as you're taking your child to school that your child is not at rest inside. You can identify that. You're attuned enough to understand that. You have a patient who walks in the door, and from all your experience inside of your understanding, okay, you understand that that patient, there's an unrest, or there probably should be an unrest. Okay, not shown on the outside maybe, but you understand from your understanding of this particular situation, there is. But you ignore it. That's what the priest did. He saw the man across the road. He stopped, looked across the road. Other people were just going by. They didn't even notice. Okay? But at least he stopped. And he looks across the road. He says, sure, there's a guy over there having a pretty bad time. So he identified the problem. But he didn't do anything about the problem. He just moved on. And more than likely, what is driving anybody who moves on is a list. It's the appointed task. Okay? It's the appointed task. Stopping by Snowy Woods by Robert Frost, which is a very famous poem, is about this whole aspect. Yes, I have miles to go before I finish my task. And he's right in the middle of a task. He's delivering something. And it's snowing in this field out here. And the pony, or the horse that he's using, stops. Makes him stop. And he's kind of, you know, and the horse won't go. And then so he starts looking around. And he sees this wood over here filling up with snow. And it's just beautiful in terms of what's going on. And so he gets involved in that. He identifies it and sees it and drifts into it. So this is the second one. First one's identification. The next one is interest. Okay, he shows interest. So the next phase of sharing would be that. And this is the Levite. Okay, there's a priest and there's a Levite. And the Levite actually stops, sees the guy across the road. Everybody's going past. He actually crosses the road. And looks at the guy up close. So he's identified it, and he's actually moved. He's got some interest in it, enough to walk across the road and look at it. Okay? And so that's a part of the whole issue of sharing. But he doesn't move any farther than that. I can see you've got a problem. It's just like your kid. You notice that I was in Wichita Falls this week taking care of the grandkids. And I took him, my grandson, to school while his parents were gone. And as I was taking my grandson to school, one of the things that I was interested in was, how is he feeling? Okay, and because this is he's kindergarten. Okay, and so first, you know, week of school. And so you're trying to clue into, you know, you're interested. You can see, you identify that there's going to be a problem. He might not even identify it, but you can identify because you've been in that experience before, and you show interest in that. Okay. Now, you can let it just go that far and never move any more than that. In other words, you're looking or whatever, but you don't ask. Or you don't go any farther than that. Or you don't pay attention even more to other signs and try to get into the last stage of sharing, which is, of course, involvement. So, identification, interest, and involvement. And, of course, the Samaritan is the one who became involved. He not only identified it, he not only crossed the road and looked at the guy, he actually touched him. Okay? And began to take care of him. So those are the three stages of a person being involved in another person's life. Okay? My dad is not here, so I can kind of work with him as an example. My dad saw at times 60 patients in a day. And he was never on schedule, so that's part of my father in terms of what's going on. But he always had this real sense of identification and interest and involvement with the life of his patient. And if he would look for, with interest, if there was a problem. And he would try to move towards that problem with involvement. And so sometimes that would run him into the schedule. Okay? And his staff would get upset with him. Number one, they had to work, just like he had to work, until he got finished. Okay? And so, you know, his nurse would walk in and kind of tap me on the shoulder. We've got about five people standing in line here. You know, you need to move on. And he'd just ignore him and continue to work with this particular person. So, you know, that's an understanding of that particular issue. And this is exactly what sharing is all about. Paul says, you identified with my affliction. You had interest in my affliction. And actually, you moved to provide for it. You supplied the need. You supplied what I needed to have. Not only physically, but you could tell from Epaphroditus, who's mentioned in this twice, once here and earlier, that friendship and that involvement was the great encouragement to his soul. And that some of the people who he had ministered had followed him all through the very time of his death. These people who he had been a part of. The ministry of his life. So it was not only a physical thing that was very important to him, it supplied a very psychologically and spiritual uplift for him. Okay. Any questions on that? Relationship to identification. All right, well, I want to open this up a little bit and have some back and forth a bit. The first principle of giving, besides what we have just been talking about, giving you some ideas about this, that comes from Paul's words here. It's found in verse 15. I gave you five principles last week, okay, right at the very end, that can be derived from this particular passage that has to do with sharing. And the first principle is verse 15, where he talks about the principle of giving and giving and receiving. And there are two parts to this. In relationship, if you look through the rest of the word word about the idea of giving and receiving in the part of sharing. In Matthew chapter 10, 8, it says, freely you have received, freely give. So it uses the same word, give and receive. But it adds a word there, freely. And the word freely is really the word grace. Okay? Grace is associated with freedom. In other words, something that was given freely. That you didn't earn it. Okay, so it's associated with grace. The principle of giving and receiving, particularly the idea of a person who steps, identifies, has interest, and walks across the road and becomes involved. What pushes a man to get involved? What is going to get you out of your normal task-related day to get involved? What's the motivation? What's a biblical motivation? One of the basic motivations that has to do with this principle is the word free. What you find is the way you understand the grace of God in your life basically drives you to give that grace to somebody else. Now let me explain that. The more you understand how much God has freely given to you, the more you've tasted, the more you've handled it, the more you've smelled it, the more that it's a part of your life, the more that you've identified it, the things that God has poured into your own soul, from that sense of gratitude, that sense of love, because you didn't earn it, but you have tasted it and felt it and known it. Okay? That is something that causes you to move to another to hand over to them grace as well. In other words, if God has given you something that you can give to them, you would long to give to them because He has given to you. Now, this is a really strong, if you study psychology and whatever, one of the major things that psychologists will do, Christian psychologists particularly, in almost any area, will, for you to be able to get past, let's say, you can't forgive somebody, which is one of the basic things that keeps people in anger, bitterness, and locked and struggle all their life, is that they can't forgive. You can lay the principle down before them, but they can't forgive. That their heart is as cold as a stone in relationship to this issue. And how many times have you been hurt, okay, and then you know the principle. You know how to heal this situation. You know that you must forgive this person, but you can't. It may take you weeks before you can go over and do what God has commanded you to do, to forgive them. But in truth, you have a hard time forgiving them. In fact, you have maybe caused a breach to occur because you both walked off and your relatives or whatever, and you haven't really spoken 20 years. And the way you handle this is not to speak, not to be in their presence, not to be a part of their lives. So that's the way you handle it. Okay? But there's no freedom here, see? There's nothing there. So what a psychologist will teach you to do is, how do you get to a point to where you can forgive somebody when your heart is as cold as a stone? You must understand how much God has forgiven you. You must see and feel what God has done for you in the area of forgiveness. And so what they try to do is to allow you to get a hold of all of your sin, all the hurt that you've given to God, all that you are in relationship to that, and how He has stepped in and His love for you has forgiven you. From that base, if He has forgiven me and I have been this way, then you can turn around and forgive somebody else. Okay? But it's only from that base. Okay. This is the same principle here. When you have tasted and felt God's giving to you, it's almost like you can't stop but give to somebody else. Now, I want you to know, and as I've looked at this, like I said, I'm your guinea pig here. I really don't like to look at these things real well because they're so convicting. I know the principle just as well as you do, but I find myself having to live with this stupid stuff, you know.
Okay.
And the question that I asked myself was, how much has this really gotten a hold of me? And that's why I ask you, give some time to look at this. This concept, how much have you really tasted the grace of God? How much is your life driven by the fact, motivated by the fact that God has given you so much? I look back at my life this morning and try to list these things. And I want to list all the things you would list. But you realize that when you look at them, they're just the things that everybody puts down. I mean, a person who is a non-Christian could put all these things down. You know, God's given me my family. Well, that's true. You know? But what does that really, you know, how have you tasted the grace of God beyond a non-Christian in relationship to your family? That has really driven you, okay, has driven you to give to that family. Okay? Now, I'm going to be really honest here, and I hate to do this, but I'm going to try to be honest here. As I've gotten older, my children, my son and my daughter, okay, I have found that their problems and the increase in their problems and their struggles, which is that I'm a part of, okay, in a relationship, have taken away the sense inside of me of them as a gift. Now, that's an honest statement. I hope that you don't take it wrong. But as life progresses, they're doing this. And my reservoir has gotten smaller and smaller and smaller in relationship to that. You know why? Because I haven't taken time enough to fill the reservoir back up with the understanding of what grace God has given to me through them. I haven't increased the reservoir. And that's the principle. See? It ebbs and flows. That's exactly right. And we gotta be really careful about this, particularly the ones of us who are older. You know, my grandchildren bring me an enormous amount of joy. My children bring me an enormous amount of problems. And those problems are something that I must go in and be a part of and identify with and minister to, and they begin to pull right out of you. Okay? And if you cannot find them as a gift, okay, and all that God has given to you through them, then in truth, you slowly but surely begin to lose things. And I can tell you this, a lot of times the reason it ebbs and flows a great deal on if they're a gift or a problem. You know, my daughter can call me up and have all sorts of things that go on and are fantastic, and I, you know, hang up and feel really good. Well, that's a gift, see. Calls me up another time, tells me all these problems and stuff like that, and then another time all these problems, another time all these problems, another time all these problems, and not, by the way, 15 minutes, but an hour and a half to 2.5 hours on the phone. And by the time you hang up, you go, you know, and you go, I thought I was finished with this, you know, But that's those are the kinds of things that you have to understand, see. That's what freely give and freely receive, the basic principle behind it is you have to understand all the grace that God has given to you. Okay? And from that, only from that, will you be able to give to somebody else. Without that understanding, you're sitting there on your own. Like every non-Christian, a child is a precious gift. Almost every non-Christian will tell you that. Not every one of them, but almost every one of them will. It's fundamental in the heart of them that God has put there. So we need to look at that. Same thing with a husband or a wife or a friend or any kind of circumstance that we're a part of. So it's an important issue, an important thing. Any questions on it? One principle. That's right.
So how could it, if you're taking it to the Father, then your reservoir should never...
That's true. Mm-hmm. That's a real good point.
We're kind of a ladder sometimes.
That's exactly right. Right. Now, I would say more people. That's exactly right. In other words, you're telling me exactly how then you would solve that issue by bringing that particular, you know, taking the problem that your daughter has presented to you and presenting it to the Lord. The problem is that you're not, or at least I'm not, perfect.
That's what I'm saying, though. Isn't that the connection between you and your relationship
yes.
with the Father?
That's exactly right.
As you ebb and as you flow, you can look at that and go, okay, that shows you how close you are to the Father.
Right.
Because as you ebb, you're farther away.
That's exactly right.
But as the reservoir
flows,
you're closer.
That's right. No, you're making sense. You understand what she's saying? Okay. So that's a good point. And there are all sorts of things that you can have within your own life that become kind of like, tests, or whatever you might say, as to your relationship. Yeah, the flags that go up.
Yeah. Oh, red flag. Oh, dear.
Yeah, yeah.
Father.
Yeah, I'm not doing this real well, then our relationship. Yeah, exactly. Good point. Okay? Let's go into another principle. Let me see if we have time for that or not. Well, the other principle of giving and receiving is found in Luke chapter 6, verse 38, where it says, "Give and it shall be given to you." And Carlin quoted this last week, pressed down, shaken, you know, over and abundantly. So as you give, essentially that will be something that will be given back to you. And what I wanted to do is ask for some examples, and we only have a few minutes, but this is a principle of the Word. As a man pours his life out to other people, giving. Okay, what you find is that comes back to you. And what I would like to ask is if you could share some things where you have given, God has asked you to give, and you have found this principle to be very, very true. That as you have reached out to give to somebody else, to share with somebody else, to be a part of their lives, what you have found is that it's come back to you, pressed down, overflowing. Can you think of anything as an example of that? Anything else that you can find? Yeah.
I guess in my situation, I've been just amazed how you don't really feel like you've given that much. You feel like you're just doing what you feel like you just normally do. You feel like getting from anyway, I guess, and you just kind of do what comes naturally, you know, try to help people. And it's amazing when you get like a situation like I'm in with this cancer situation, and just the amount of people that will just surround you and just come out from almost a woodwork. I mean, it's just amazing. People are putting me on like on prayer lists with their churches. People don't even know me were praying for me. And the very next day, after I told people about my diagnosis, that was a call. card on my desk that they'd all signed, and it was just amazing how quickly and how they, how abundantly they moved. I mean, it was just overwhelming.
Okay.
And it really is such an uplifting feeling to know, you know, you don't really feel like you've done anything major in anybody's life, but
right.
you have touched them in some way. And then when they do come back at you, it's just like, oh my gosh, it's so
yeah.
wonderful.
Yeah. Good. Appreciate that. Anything else? I remember on my daughter's wedding day that even just a small thing where so many friends of mine showed up on my daughter's wedding day. And of course, I've never had, but I have one daughter. And so I'd never gone through this experience before. I haven't been to lots of weddings. And, you know, it just, you go, I mean, I went to a wedding last night. I go to a wedding almost every weekend. Okay. And so, because I'm a teacher and all these people are getting married all the time. And you know, you're there, your presence, you know, they tell you how much they appreciate and whatever, and you go, yeah, yeah, you know, and go on. But when they all came to my daughter's wedding, and I stood in a line and shook their hands, and the sharing of that moment was so meaningful to me. Okay. In other words, that they would be willing to come and share it with me. Because at that time, it was a very meaningful moment. I remember my daughter trying to go down the aisle really fast, you know, because she was nervous and she wanted to get down in the front. And I was just sitting there trying to hold her down. Because, you know, this is the only time I'm going to walk down this aisle, you know, with you. And so, you know, all of a sudden you realize that that's happening, and people who would be willing to come to share that with me, okay, that came back, okay, and so just in small things like that, so that's the giving and the receiving, it's a part of it that's really, really meaningful in a person's life. Well, our time's up, so we will get into the last principles next week, and into the last few verses.